so many people attending MAGFest that National Harbor actually ran out of parking. But I like begged and pleaded. I tried to bribe, but he wouldn't take it. And now I'm here. Okay, well, I'm extremely excited to see you all here. I hope that by the end of this session, I convince at least one of you that I'm not completely wrong. We'll see. So very briefly about myself, my name is Brock Brown, which is not as exciting as it looks. I am a PhD doctoral student in the philosophy department at the University of Maryland, and my dissertation is titled, Are Video Games Art? Yes. Which no one likes, that question. Most people think it's either an obvious yes or an obvious no. Most of you are probably in the first camp. Roger Ebert is the second. I think that you're all wrong. I think that video games can be art, but very importantly, as I hope to demonstrate this afternoon, there are cases that we should really care about where they are not art. And those are, importantly, when they're games. So the first I want to just couch this discussion a little bit and talk about why people care about this question about whether video games are art or not. So I think it's for three main reasons. One, video game criticism, by and large, is bad. It has only very recently emerged from product reviews. And they were treated like a new release of a cell phone, and people didn't care about, or didn't take the time to care about the things they ought to have cared about with video games. And only recently has that started happening. And I think that one of the ways that people saw out of bad video game criticism was to just treat it like art, and just use our art critical tools, apply to video games, and we're done. That's the second point. We have tools to talk about artworks, so it would be really nice if all video games turned out to be artworks, because a lot of the difficult work of criticism about figuring out how to talk about video games would already be done for us. We would still have hard work to do to like figure out how to apply it correctly, but it would be like trying to use like a saw to cut down a strangely shaped tree instead of trying to develop a new tool all on its own. And finally, and I think this is both, on one hand, like the most reasonable of the reasons, and also like the most desperate, is to give video games an air of legitimacy, right? I'd really like to be able to convince my dad that I did not waste my adolescence playing video games, because the whole time I was engaged with art objects. Dad. He's actually fine. So the art status of video games, I'm coming from the philosophy world, in particularly the Western analytic philosophy world, where we're very dry and very boring. And these are some other very dry, boring people. But all of them have assumed, without question, something that I want to challenge. They have all said that video games are artworks. This is Grant Tabnor. He's got a very good book, The Art of Video Games. Don Lopez has a very good book, A Philosophy of Computer Art, with a very mediocre chapter on video games, but it's not his fault. And finally, Aaron Smuts has a very interesting paper that is 100% wrong. He's an awesome guy. He's really fun. If you ever meet him, hang out with him, because you will drink all night and it will be amazing. But he's completely wrong. He thinks that all art theories include video games. They make this assumption that video games are games. And some of them argue that video games are games. And that's actually fine. I'm not here to argue this point exactly tonight. The bigger assumption from all of this arguing is not whether video games can be art, but we need to take a step back and ask a different question, which is whether games can be art. They all assume that video games are games, which seems like a fair enough assumption. It's in the name. But I want to challenge this and say that not all video games are games, and it's a good thing that that's the case, because all games cannot be art. Whether it's a video game, a board game, role-playing game, any of those things cannot be artworks. But I'm also going to say that that's okay, and in many cases it's a good thing, because we don't want those things to be artworks for certain reasons. So this is my thesis. This is what I'm going to try to convince you of in your very encouraged disagree with. Something being a game is incompatible with it being an artwork. So for any object in the world, if it's a game, it cannot be an artwork, and if it's an artwork, it cannot be a game. It might be neither, but it can never, ever, ever, in any case, ever, be both. Okay, so this is the technical part. Three points of incompatibility. I'm going to give them in sort of lay terms, and then I'm going to give them in a theoretical sense that you might be familiar with if you guys have been reading some of this literature. So these points of incompatibility. One, games and artworks have goals, and those goals, the thing you're supposed to do in them, is part of what makes them what they are. Those cannot be the same thing between a game and an artwork. I'm also going to argue that games have a kind of arbitrary inefficiency built in. It's part of what makes them a game instead of something else, like a job. Artworks cannot have this kind of inefficiency. And each requires a particular kind of attitude. Artworks aren't just things that like hang on walls, and games aren't just things that sit in boxes in closets. They are things that have prescriptions attached to them. When someone makes a game, or makes an artwork, or engages with either of these two things, it's not just that they're like physically proximal to the object, right? They're not just near it. They're engaging with it with a certain attitude, a kind of way. And I'm also going to argue that you can't engage with an object in the same way between a game and an artwork at the same time. Okay. So the technical literature calls these terms the prelusory goal, lusory means, and illusory attitude. Lusory is from the Latin ludic, meaning play. This isn't going to make a whole lot of sense on this slide, but I'm going to talk about these in specifics and use examples. And then you guys will be experts, at least good enough to go tell everybody else why you're right. Okay, so the overview is going to go like this. I'm going to talk about games, I'm going to tell you what games are. Then we're going to talk about artworks, and I'm not going to tell you what artworks are. But I'm going to tell you something very important about artworks, that's all we need to know. Then I'm going to talk about the incompatibility argument that I just showed you and make sense of it. And if we have time, we're going to talk about an object that seems very much like a counterexample to everything I'm talking about. It looks like a board game, it talks like a board game, it walks like a board game, but it's very obviously art. And if it is those things, I'm wrong, so I'm going to try to show that out. Okay, so games. What are games? We are here, presumably, at a game festival. I mean, music, of course, but also games. And I'm not talking just about video games, I'm talking about just any kind of game, from chess to, like, Monopoly to Mega Man, Magic the Gathering, all games. Oh, yeah. Final Fantasy, I don't know, maybe art.
Train.
Yeah, right. Okay. So who here has heard of Bernard Suits? Anybody? Yeah, we got a couple people. He has an amazing book. He was a philosopher, but he wrote a book in the 70s called The Grasshopper, Games Like Utopia. And he wrote it in the style of a Greek dialogue, like a Socratic dialogue. But the main characters are from Aesop's fable about the grasshopper and the ant. And in that, you know how it goes, right? The ant works all summer, saving. The grasshopper plays, winter comes, no food, the grasshopper dies because the ant. I mean, they worked really hard and kept all their food, but they're also kind of a jerk and let the grasshopper starve. But the moral of the story is don't have fun, work, save all your, you know, whatever. Suits argues that that's actually backwards. If you want the best life, you should care about playing so much that you'd be willing to starve to death so you can play a little bit more instead of leading the hollow kind of life where put down games and pick up work. I dare you. All right, for those of you who are familiar with philosophy in the 20th century, might know that there's already a gigantic roadblock. There's this guy, Ludwig Wittgenstein. He used games as like the paradigm case of a thing that cannot be defined, and then Suits goes out and defines it. But he didn't do a very good job. Wittgenstein's a genius, sure, he did all this good work, but he got really lazy here. And he said, there's like a little caveat in what he says. Because I'm going to tell you that games can't be defined. Look, like baseball and soccer and card games and hide and go seek and games of make-believe, these are so different. They couldn't all be the same thing. And he says, you can't just say they're the same thing. You have to go look and see. And then he stops, and he doesn't look, and he doesn't see. But he's like, look, there's no definition. I didn't give you one. There can't be one. Well, Bernard suits. He goes, he looks, he sees, and he goes, aha, Wittgenstein, you're wrong. And I even have support for this view. Thomas Herka, another person that we don't need to know who that is, says that Suits has nothing like Wittgenstein's philosophical reputation. But on this topic, he's the real philosopher. If I said that out loud to certain rooms, all of their hair would catch on fire. All right, so here it is. If you didn't know what a game was before you walked in, you'll know now. Here's what Suits says. To play a game is to attempt to achieve a specific state of affairs, what he calls the prelusory goal, using only means permitted by rules, which are the lucidary means, where the rules prohibit use of more efficient in favor of less efficient means, the constituent rules, and where the rules are accepted, they are accepted just because they make such activity possible, the lucidary attitude. He gives us a portable version, which is a little easier to say all at once. Playing a game is the voluntary attempt to overcome unnecessary obstacles. So reflect on every game you've ever played and all the things you've ever done that aren't games and see if this captures one of those categories and not the other. Here we go. All right, so just to be clear, this actually isn't a definition of games, it's a definition of game playing, but it's very easy to switch a room. You just add, you alter the lucidary attitude. Instead of it just the condition that a player has, you just make it a prescription from whoever makes the game or whoever takes it up in an ersatz way, that they're supposed to play it with this kind of attitude. Because of course, I can make a game and either you don't think it's very good or you don't like me very much, and you just decide, well, I'm not going to play it. And you go, aha, I'm not engaging it with the right attitude. You fail to make a game. But instead, it's just that you're supposed to. So that's going to solve that problem, at least. All right, well, what are prelusory goals actually? Right? How do we distinguish these from others? All that it is a specific achievable state of affairs. Just any condition you can imagine, you can make that the goal of a game. Now, you might have to work harder depending on what you pick. But you can pick like terrible things, like hitting like an exact score on the GRE. Right? I don't know why you'd want to play this game, but you could play it. I'll have other examples of terrible games in the future. But here's a really nice example of a prelusory goal. So this is the Boston Marathon. This is Lisa Weidenbach. She was the last American woman to win the Boston Marathon. This was back in 85. This is the prelusory goal. Cross the finish line. Okay. Now, there are a lot of ways you can do this. You can start at the start of the marathon and only run using your legs and stay within the borders of the track and be a human and there be like the laws of physics and then try to cross the finish line. There are much easier ways to achieve this goal, which is like stand in the crowd over here and then when like they fire the starting gun, just walk over the line. That's what I would do. Chess, the prelusory goal is checkmate, right? Put your opponent's king in a place such that they can't move anymore. And Monopoly is, I don't know, make all your friends angry at you, have all the property.
Sounds about right.
So the prelusory goals are distinct from the lucidary goal, which is winning. Winning is achieving the prelusory goal only by following the rules. There's lots of ways to achieve these prelusory goals, right? I could ride a motorcycle and go way faster than my opponents. I could tie them up. I could kill them all at the beginning of the race. Anything, and I win, right? Here, oh, I need to make it so that your king doesn't move. Well, I could glue it to the board, right? I could just hold it there with my hand when you try to move it away. Go, ha, 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 I win. Lots of people achieve the prelusory goal of Monopoly through illicit means. You just have to be the banker. Send yourself some 500s and you're well on your way. So the illusory goal means winning only by following the rules. So there's lots of ways of getting there that don't count as winning, because you weren't even playing. If you're a little suspicious of this, especially in the chess case, because you're thinking, well, you can't have checkmate without the rules of chess, there's a little nice distinction you might make between a game proper and the institution of the game. So you've got all the rules of chess, and you have to have them in place for checkmate to make sense, because checkmate isn't just like a configuration in space, right? It's all of the rules and what the spaces mean and how the pieces move and all of that. Well, that's okay. In fact, we engage with the rules of chess often without playing chess, right? Like when we are learning how to play chess, we look at a lot of things like this, where the board is set up this way. They don't teach you how to play chess by saying, well, first we have to have all of the black pieces on one side and all the white pieces on the other, and then watch real quick as I do all these moves, and then ta-da, we're here, now what do you do? No. They just set it up and say, well, look, this is the king, he can move in any direction one spot at a time. And they clear everything else away so they can let you engage with the institution of chess without the difficulty of playing a whole game every time. So winning. Winning is what we care about when we play games. It's like one of the things we care about. And achieving the pre-lusory goal using only the lusory means is the only way to win. Which is why, it's actually a really nice analysis of why it's true that cheaters never win. Because they were never playing. They were doing something else.
Thank you.
You never won, Roger. Cheater. Okay, so I'm going to give you these two at once because they're very related. Constitutive rules and lusory means. Constitutive rules. All this is the rules combined with the pre-lusory goal determine the identity of a game. Okay? So you have some goal. You sit somebody down and teach them how to play a game. You say, here's what you're trying to do. You're trying to get to this place, you're trying to acquire these points, trying to do some achievement. But you're only allowed to do it this way. Right? This is what makes basketball much more interesting than if you give people ladders. Right? Gotta put the ball in the hoop, but you have to dribble it to get away from where you are. Like, it's very weird rules when you think about it. And those rules dictate illusory means, because usually what the constitutive rules do is they say all the things you can't do. The illusory means are all the things you are allowed to do. So the rules of basketball say you can't just like hold the ball like a rugby ball and just run down the court and knock people away. You have to dribble it, you can't charge, all of that stuff. The means are just those things that are left allowed. And we find this to evolve out of games in really interesting ways, right? This is why, this can happen in a couple ways. So somebody mentioned, I think you mentioned like Magic the Gathering, right? Magic the Gathering gets designed, and they say, here's all the things you can do and here's all the things you can't do. But designing and balancing a game of that magnitude is really difficult. And what happens is millions of people start playing, and people start finding the cracks. They say, well, I'm not allowed to do this, I'm not allowed to do that. But the game does allow me to do this other thing that, oh man, I win every time I do it. And what game designers often do is they alter the game then to eliminate that, because it's not in the spirit of the game. But to return to the basketball example, we see this is how like time clock management works. This is why, depending on your inclinations, the last 5 minutes of a basketball game are either the most exciting or the least exciting. Because it's just foul, timeout, out of bounds, stop the clock. But whatever those means are of accomplishing the goal, a game always makes it such that they are not maximally efficient. They're not the easiest way of achieving that state of affairs. And this distinguishes games from technical activities. Technical activities are like digging a ditch. When you dig a ditch, you want to get it done. So if you've got a shovel, you use a shovel. If you have a backhoe, you use a backhoe. If you happen to own a construction company, you just hire other people. Right? You want it done. You're not doing it for its own sake. This is very different from golf. The pre-lusory goal of golf is to hit this stupid white ball inside this stupid hole that's stupidly far away. what would be great is if I was allowed to walk right up to that hole and just place it in, like an 18. But instead, they say, here's what would be fun. Walk 350 yards away, and then take this lumpy piece of metal with a stick on the end of it, and you have to hit it with that. Not the most efficient way. Yeah.
But aren't you just changing the definition by changing the goal? The goal of golf is not to put a ball in the hole. The goal of golf is to use physics to arc a ball that far. The goal is an arbitrary objective at the end. The art is to use equipment to create physics.
That's right. I mean, you're right. Is that a satisfying response? But the point is always that you can separate a final state that could be gotten at more efficiently. Right?
Depending on where you define the final state.
That's right. No, that's always right. But in ditch digging, right, if I could, there's always a way that if I could always define it, or rather, if I could achieve it more efficiently, I would do it that way. Right? If I could snap my fingers and the ditch was there, that'd be awesome. Yeah, one more.
Is ditch digging under a budget a game then? Because I could spend my entire, life's work on, getting a more efficient ditch digging tool. Yeah. But I'd rather not. So is the budget a game?
Right. No. And I'll tell you a short reason why now and a slightly better long reason why in 7 minutes.
Okay.
The budget restricts how efficient I can be. Right. I can do as efficiently as I can given something that I'm not able to alter. But also, were I able to alter it, I wouldn't choose to work within that budget. But if I did, that would be a game. If for no reason other than I like that kind of activity of trying to dig a ditch while spending only $173, you've got yourself a game. I don't know how great it is, but a game nonetheless. So, on this distinction, maybe this will clarify a bit. The rules dictate inefficient means relative to the prelusory goal. So you're trying to do something, they say, here's a not-so-good way to do it. And that allows the player to pursue the illusory goal within those means, however, as efficiently as possible, right? I'm not allowed to just, write a zero on the health points of every monster I encounter in Dungeons & Dragons, right? That would be a really easy way to win. I'm not allowed to do that. But in the ways that I am allowed to do it, I am allowed to act as efficiently within those constraints, right? I don't always make my fighter only literally hamstring yourself, right? Or tie one hand behind your back, or be like, I've got all these powerful spells, but I won't use them. It would be too efficient, right? Within the constraints that I've chosen, because they're inefficient, and that inefficiency is interesting for whatever reason, then I can act as efficiently as possible. So soccer players, they try their damnedest to get that ball in the net, but they'll never pick it up, usually. Yeah.
One could argue that the things that make games games, there's no global minimum, right? There's no perfectly efficient way of doing them, because if there was, everybody would achieve them, and then everybody would win, and you couldn't. So the thing that would make a game is that there is no efficient way of doing something within the illusory goals. Otherwise, everybody would play the game in the exact same way, and technically, no one would win.
I think you've defined what makes a good game. Because here's a game that's bad, and people like us don't play it because it's solved. Tic-tac-toe. Mm-hmm. Right? You play tic-tac-toe enough and you go, well, this game sucks. Because I either win every time or I stalemate every time. And the only way to lose is to make a mistake. Right? In fact, Knots and Crosses, or OXO, one of the first video games ever created back in the 50s, was a perfectly solved tic-tac-toe game, which meant the best you could do was tie the computer. And all you could do was play and hope not to make a mistake. Right? So not so great. So a quick point about illusory attitude. So what is this thing? What is this state of mind that you're supposed to have when you play a game? Okay. This is the idea that you accept the rules and the way that they make achieving the goal inefficient just for the sake of making that activity possible. Right? Basketball players do not care about that ball going through that hoop for its own sake. If they did, they'd climb the ladder and put it through the hoop as many times as they could, and they'd be like, this is awesome. Look at how many times I'm doing this thing that I love, right? They don't care about that. They want to play, they want to do it by the rules, because that's awesome, because it's a challenge that they like, right? They want to have to dribble, they want to have to depend on their teammates, and they have to beat people that are really good. It's the same idea of why when you get good at a game, you don't want to keep playing your, like, two-year-old niece. Because it's not fun for you and it's really mean to her. So here's something that you can do, however, that's not a game, but you can treat like a game. You can take up illusory attitude with lots of things. Traffic. You could be like a sick, twisted person who wants to, like, you're like, all right, it's Friday, it's 5:30. Time to get on the beltway. Because there's just nothing I like more than trying to get somewhere else, but only by obeying the rules of the road. I don't need to be there. I don't have a reason to be there. I'm just going to pick a point and love trying to get there. Yeah.
I don't mean to derail, but it almost feels like through these illusory goals, you're proving that there are. Because what's the difference from following these abstract rule sets to keep you on course instead of doing it more efficiently than being a cubist or a ballerina or someone with tap? All of these use illusory goals in the creation of art. In fact, they're required.
I couldn't have segued better. I swear to you, this man is not a plant.
But I'm might just have, an artist and a game tester.
But I may have to buy him a beer later. Yeah, one more question right there, at this point.
I was just curious if you considered like professional sports games in some circumstances, because there are players and coaches and sometimes they get caught cheating. And in that situation, they're not playing the game by your definition, but they're still playing a game.
Yeah, so there's actually like a whole raft of literature on this about whether cheaters are should automatically be excluded from things like Hall of Fames for this very reason, right? I think I have a slide on this.
Wouldn't that be the definition, the difference between a player and a competitor?
Well, yeah. So there's this really interesting discussion that we can't have right now, but I would love to have with any of you after this, which is the difference between games and competitions and whether they always overlap. You might think that something like a wine competition isn't a game, but you could make it into one if you did the right kinds of things. But yeah, with professional athletes, you want to be careful because we might not want to exclude people who are playing games for money from actually being players, while also preserving a distinction that lets amateur play be more pure, right? But I think that this can handle that. But now we have to talk about artworks, because we're running out of time.
Art.
So art. I could tell you what it is.
Oh.
But I won't.
I thought it was art.
But I will say something that I think is always true about an artwork, that it is meant to be appreciated.
Pause for effect.
You can appreciate something negatively.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. Yeah. Yes, to loathe something when appropriate is to not only appreciate it, but appreciate it correctly. Yeah, appreciate is not, I mean this not in the evaluative sense, but in the classic rhetoric sense. And I'll say this about appreciation. When you want to appreciate something for what it is, you have to appreciate it for its relevant features. For instance, a wrong way to appreciate the Mona Lisa is because of how much it weighs, or what color the canvas is on the backside of it, or what it tastes like. All interesting ways of appreciating it, but not appropriate. Not because you couldn't make an artwork that had those kinds of features, but because for the Mona Lisa, as far as we know, those are not the relevant features that Leonardo had in mind. And just the converse of that is that the relevant features of a work are those that contribute to its proper appreciation understanding, whatever those features happen to be. This is why you can have like Robert Rauschenberg he makes these things that look like weird flat sculptures hanging on the wall, but he says they're paintings. You're supposed to appreciate them as weird 3D paintings, not as odd flat sculptures. Both odd, but odd for different reasons. Okay, this is just a bunch of people that agree with me.
Those things look too impressive.
Yes, yes. I even know their first ones. I've even met some of them. You got it. You're totally on board. All right. So they're meant to be appreciated. Good enough. And I'll say this. Part of what makes a feature relevant is what the artist intended. It doesn't fully determine it. They're not... Okay, artists are like God in some ways, in that they actually can like create ex nihilo, which is amazing. They're not just reconfiguring bits of space and matter. They're actually making something exist that didn't exist before. But just shy of God, they can't fully determine like all the properties of that thing because we're fallible. So sometimes somebody wants to make like a really poignant, emotional story about a father-son relationship and how that matters deeply to all of us, but instead that person's Michael Bay and accidentally made Transformers. So sometimes these are physical features of the work, when the work is physical, or formal features when it's an abstract thing. Other times it's about the context of creation, right? I write a piece of music, it sounds an awful lot like Mozart, that counts as derivative. When Mozart did it, it was original. Thus, artworks call for a particular kind of attitude towards them when we appreciate them. It means that when you engage with an artwork, you have to be trying to do the right kind of thing, and in the right kind of way, to be doing it right. And all that is, I'll call that just the artistic attitude, right? That means that there's a way of appreciating the Mona Lisa that are like, there's maybe a lot of ways of doing it the right way. The wrong way is like, well, I've got this hole in my wall, and I'm pretty sure this will like spackle over that pretty nicely in the winter, right? You can do that. Lots of artworks have affordances that are inappropriate. Okay, so incompatibility argument. Why can't one object be both a game and an artwork? We're gonna assume, for reductio, I'm gonna assume a kind of object exists, tell you all of its features, and then show you why that thing can't actually. And it's this thing, artwork game X. Some person, supposedly, for the sake of argument, makes an object, and it's both an artwork and a game. Here's all the features that thing's gonna have, right? Oh, just a side note. Don't confuse artworks and art appreciation as the same thing. One is an activity, one is an object. So it's possible that you could turn the appreciation of an artwork into a game if you jump through the right hoops, which might also be one of the rules of the game. But that wouldn't make the artwork the game, right? You could turn like arriving at the Louvre into a game and then like film it and sell it to like NBC or something. That wouldn't turn the Louvre into a game. Okay. So here, nice chess set. You take that, you put it into an art gallery, we're done. I'm already wrong. No, because this is not chess. That's just a chess set. And those aren't the same thing, right? This is the paraphernalia of a game, right? It's not the right kind of appropriation, repurposing. That's not how you make an artwork game. Similarly, the fountain, this is not still a urinal. This is just an object that used to be a urinal. That's why you're not allowed to piss in it. But it used to be a urinal, which is why it's still very interesting when people try to. And they have, and it's awesome. But conversely, this also did not turn every men's bathroom into an art gallery. Right? All the other bands, says me. All the other urinals are still just not artworks. Whoops. Oh yeah, there we go, awesome. You guys familiar with this guy?
Yep.
Diego Leclerc? He did something awesome for an artist. He got a spot in the Whitney Biennial. And they were like, cool, you just, whatever kind of work you want to do, put it in there. But then, he's like also a regular person, and he wasted his whole life playing Civ 5, and was like, whoops, shit, I have to put a piece of work in the Whitney, and instead of him playing Civ 5 all this time, I know what I'll do. I'll just set up this desk. If you've been to, this is the old Whitney. There's like a drawbridge over a dry moat. He just like was like, give me a power strip. And I'll sit down there and like, in like self-imposed exile because I dropped the ball. But my artwork is me playing Civ 5. It's all the stuff I did when I was supposed to be making art. This is an artwork. This is a performance piece. This is art. And it might be even smart art. Good art. I didn't want to say that. Clever art. There you go. But it does not turn Civilization 5 into art. But we've still got this object for assumption. An artwork and a game. How does it go? Well, it's going to have a prelusory goal. It's going to have something that you're trying to achieve. It's going to have constitutive rules that are going to determine the illusory means for what you can and can't do. It's going to require the illusory attitude. And it's going to require the artistic attitude. Because it's both an artwork and a game. So it's got these things. If such an object can exist, I'm wrong. Here's the illusory goal, right? Here's what you're trying to do with an artwork by following all the rules. Understand the work by attending to all of its relevant features. How do we get the prelusory goal? Well, it's very easy. You just take illusory goal and take away the means for achieving it. Understand the work. That's all you're supposed to do with the work of art. Understand it, whatever it's supposed to be, right? That doesn't mean that there's a single way of understanding it, or only one right way, but it does mean that that's what you're supposed to do, right? And all that that understanding means, remember, is paying attention to its relevant features. That means that it's not the right way to appreciate a gallery of paintings by putting on a blindfold, wandering through, and going, ah, that was good. The rules can be whatever the artist decides. As long as they obstruct the viewer from efficiently achieving the prelusory goal, right? That could be anything. They could do all kinds of weird stuff. And the player accepts these rules not for any other reason other than that they just say, you know what? That creates a kind of striving that I want to partake in. Now, the illusory attitude, this is the stuff I want to talk about really briefly. It does not result in radical autotelism, meaning that the only way a thing can be a game is if you can only ever play it only for the sake of playing the game. That would be stupid and really easy for me to be right, which is not a great way to be right. So a game need not be played only for its own sake, right? You can play a game for all kinds of reasons. Fame, fortune, fitness. These are reasons to play basketball, reasons athletes play professional sports. You know, I don't like, man, all right, let me just totally sacrifice myself for you. I don't like Pandemic, board game, but if my friends want to play, I will totally play with them just to like hang out and have a good social time. That doesn't mean I'm not playing a game. And the reason for that is that the important thing is not that you have to be playing it just for its own sake, but that you always could be playing it just for its own sake. At any moment, I could be like, you know what, I'm wrong. Pandemic is awesome. Let's play it just because I like to play it. Oh, how intimidating. Okay, here we go. Artworks cannot have a prelusory goal. Because the prelusory goal is to understand the artwork. And for it to be a prelusory goal, it must be separable from the means of achieving it, which means there's got to be a lot of different ways of achieving it. For instance, there's no way of understanding the artwork in the same way that I can inappropriately cross the finish line of a race. Because understanding an artwork means you understand it by appreciating all of its relevant features. To not do that isn't just to understand it wrong, but is to not understand it at all. Which means there's no other way to get to it. There's only one way to understand a work of art. That goal always includes the means. Which makes it always not only the only way, not only a good way of understanding a work of art, but the only way of understanding a work of art. Which actually turns artwork appreciation into a technical activity. Not because it's work and it sucks, but because you're trying to understand it in the very best way possible. It just turns out that that's a very enjoyable thing that a lot of us like to do. Now, there's two ways you can go about this. Both are bad, of trying to resolve this problem. You can accept that the illusory means are part of the goal, and thus the goal is inseparable from them. This does preserve the art status of Artwork Game X, but it destroys or undermines its game status. The other horn of the dilemma is you deny that the illusory memes are part of the goal, and thus allowing it to be separable. But this, of course, preserves the game status and destroys the art status. Because now all of a sudden you're going to say, I can appreciate this work of art without attending to its relevant features, which I think one cannot do, and every artist would reject. There's also a kind of an infinite regress where you can, like, the artist could be like really fast and like always adding like a new rule, be like, we're trying to get to like that state, this other way, another way, but that's just going to become like an infinite regress. So the means of achieving the illusory goal are the relevant features of the work, meaning that attending to them is part of appreciating the work. Because of this, the artistic attitude, that means you have to attend to the illusory means. You can't get it any other way. Yes?
In order to, the goal of art is to appreciate the work by attending to its relevant features.
Yes.
Do you have to attend to all of its relevant features?
I think that the answer has to be yes. And that is the hallmark of what good art criticism is. So the question is, does it mean that you have to attend to all of its relevant features? And I think the answer is yes. Good art critics do something amazing, which is not that they don't just pass judgment. They don't just give like thumbs up, thumbs down to artworks. That's maybe a feature of good art criticism, but I doubt it. Good art criticism is sensitive to works in a way that they're able to describe works and what's important about them to other people in ways that allow the other people, people like me, to then see a work and understand it in a way that I couldn't on my own. And I think that the only way of doing that in a complete way is to be attending to all of its relevant features and not ignoring them. That doesn't mean we can't do good work by doing incomplete or not fully accurate art criticism or art appreciation, but I think that the goal is always get all of it.
So a video game, not a game, that is art, would be one that you can only appreciate where the goal has to be to experience everything.
I think that's right. Well, let me be clear. All of its relevant features. Now, it may be that because of human constraints, so the question is, what about a video game that's art, appreciating all of its relevant features? Let's pretend that Grand Theft Auto is art. Here's what I can't do, is I cannot experience every feature that Grand Theft Auto can make manifest to me. It's possible, it's finite, it's a finite object, possibly, but I'm not an infinite object, I'm much more finite than Grand Theft Auto. I'm gonna die one day, sadly, not having seen everything that Grand Theft Auto has to offer. If I had to experience everything about it, and every single iteration of it counted as a relevant feature for appreciating it, that would mean that one could never appreciate Grand Theft Auto as an art work fully. But I would reject that. I would say the relevant features for interactive works, because of their usually infinite possibility space, means that the way the relevant features that an artist intends are, I'll use the word grokking, this is a perfectly fine audience for that, is to grok the possibilities, which are the interactive possibilities that the work affords, in a way that lets you feel out the kind of things that you're able to do that the creator intended.
But why, in that case, why can't choosing the features that you were going to be, that you were going to take in as part of consuming the work be the illusory means?
Oh, they are what would otherwise be the illusory means. This is where the crazy overlap goes. So were you able to separate them, they would count as illusory means. Because they're relevant, right, they can't be these inefficient ways of achieving it. Because the only way I can appreciate Grand Theft Auto is to play by the rules. They're the only thing that lets me do it. Appreciating, so for instance, Rampage. You can beat Rampage. I did it one time when I was a kid. It was amazing. It was actually a big letdown. It's a very boring congratulations screen. But like achieving that, like hacking the cartridge to get that screen to show up, is not the goal, right? It's getting there by pressing the buttons in the right way and having the experiences that I'm choosing to have, because I don't have to be doing it. Were I able to get to whatever the understanding of the work is, assuming Rampage is an artwork, which I wouldn't do, it's just a really awesome game and it should be appreciated thusly. there would be no other way of getting at the understanding of it. Right? It would be some kind of counterfeit interaction. Right? Some kind of fake, I got to the end, and now I appreciate it. Let me move on really quickly. Just one last bit. We're going to skip the train thing because I want to talk to you guys and have some questions. An object is what it is when it is that thing. Meaning, when someone selects it or designs it or creates it and they intend you to treat it a certain way, that's more or less static until it's been appropriately converted into something else. Which means that games are supposed to be treated like games, artworks are supposed to be treated like artworks for the whole time that they're those things. So Artwork Game X is supposed to have both the illusory and the artistic attitudes, but it can't. Because while the artistic attitude might be inclusive of other kinds of attitudes, the illusory attitude isn't. Because to play a game, for something to be a game, means you engage with it. It creates a kind of striving activity. It allows you to do a thing with challenges that you want to do, that you choose to do. That's what a good game is. Bad games are the ones that make you do things you don't want to do. But that it's a game means that the only reason you have to take up that activity is because you want to. You could have other reasons to do it, but it would still count as a game if the only reason you did it was for that reason. It's because it makes that activity possible. And that's just a straightforward incompatibility. Because if you're always allowed to treat it like a game and only a game, to then also have to treat it like an artwork and appreciate it for these other features would mean when you appreciate something that's supposed to be both as just a game, it means you're not treating it appropriately as an artwork. Right? So while one person's playing to win, but not paying attention to the relevant features in the right way, they're not treating it as an artwork, which is wrong. Were it an artwork. Conversely, if something's a game and a person's treating it like an artwork, that's fine, but they need not do it. You can just play Chutes and Ladders for its own sake. Right? You don't have to be really sensitive to the graphics of the board or something. Okay, I'm not going to talk about train, because I want to talk to you guys. So more questions. Someone that I haven't talked to. Yeah, right? No, I have talked to you. You said something interesting. I want to hear something interesting from someone way in the back.
What are your thoughts on things like early interactive cinema, slash space age, things like that?
Yeah, so interactive stuff is really interesting because I think that the main point from this is games and artworks are just meant to be treated differently, right? And you might even think that you could have exactly the same object and let's say two people create it at the same time for whatever reason. One person intends it as an artwork, the other person intends it as a game. One's an artwork and one's a game. But that means the experience of engaging with them is going to be differently because you're going to treat them differently, right? There's plenty of room for interactive art. Interactive art has been going on for as long as we've had interactivity, which is longer than we've had computers. But there's also computer interactivity, and as long as we've had them, we've had interactive art too.
I mean, it still feels like we're basically saying this is, in essence, an interactive art. When your possibilities start reducing down to the concept where you can't appreciate the content of the game. I mean, we're talking about a game that has a finite number of outcomes.
Yes.
And it's rather finite if it's compared to modern.
That's right. That's right.
But the evolution of modern games. Where does that distinction stop, or did it even start, you know?
Oh, do you mean like between finite and infinite possibility spaces?
Oh, right.
So I think this is just a red herring. People get really excited about whether something's fully experienceable or not.
I mean, that's even part of your statement here.
Oh,
That you could not experience outcome, the full outcomes and this whole...
Oh, yeah. I mean, well, that's just true of a whole lot of things. Right, I can't experience like every possible visual presentation of most modern video games just because there's so many of them. Right, but it's also true that I can't reasonably look at like every angle of the sculpture. Right, so like Michelangelo's David or David, I'm not allowed to like hang my wires over it and look down on it. That is a way of experiencing the work, whether it's appropriate or relevant. This is sort of the point, right? Michelangelo like, didn't have that in mind. In fact, it's designed, it's really weird. If you get, they do have photographs of looking at the David straight on. And he's got like this big baby head, right? It's like not anatomically correct because you're supposed to be looking up at him. And so to see it right, you have to, he had to make the shoulders bigger and the hands bigger. And like, as it goes down the body, other things get smaller and smaller, very embarrassingly for David. So there are ways of experiencing a thing, even with classic art objects, that you don't have to experience all of them to be able to properly experience all the relevant features of the work. And I think that the same thing holds true with interactive computer works, like most video games. Yeah?
You were talking earlier about they made a series of three-dimensional paintings that were supposed to be appreciated as paintings.
That's right. Yeah, so, I mean, this is a very astute question. I mean, I think this is the point that people have been trying to get at. But the idea is here, so you want to appreciate, like, Rauschenberg's bed, right? Which looks like a bed, but it's just a flat canvas with, like, a sheet glued on it, and it's, like, dirty, and, like, parts of it are hanging off. There's a pillow glued onto it. You're supposed to appreciate it as a painting, because that's what he made. He made a painting that's lumpy. He didn't make, like, a mostly flat sculpture.